Everyone's mistakes in that, everyone's grammatical errors, everyone's spelling mistakes. When you are aiming for work perfection, it boosts your self-esteem.
But what I read is, instead of saying perfect, I should try for excellence, not yes, for perfect. Because perfection is the, nobody can be perfect. Nobody
but then don't you link your esteem to the goal and what if you're not able to achieve that goal?
I'll come to that point in the last one, jumping ahead of your mind is fast, racing faster than mine. Hey, when it comes to taking self-responsibility, it is another point that I wanted to keep in mind. But sometimes people take responsibility for things that are not in their control. That's also an issue which affects your self-esteem. This is not in my control, but I still take responsibility for that. You know, and you can hear it in people's words. Suppose when you say, when you tell your friend that I'll meet you tomorrow at 5 o'clock in the park, you go for a walk. It starts raining. Go for a walk. Do you apologize for the rain?
Some people apologize excessively.
Excessively, isn't it? Do you apologize when you say, I'm really sorry it rained? What is it? What are you saying, I'm really sorry it rained? Is it in your control, that part of it? You're taking responsibility for things which are not in your control. So self-responsibility means taking responsibility for things in your control. Not in your control. Later is not in your control. Something else happens, some train is coming late. You go to receive your boss at the train. The train is coming late, you say, sorry, the train came late. What are you responsible for that? But you often find that. People respond apologizing for things which are not in their control. Right? So that's also a self-responsibility issue. Now, don't take responsibility for things in your not control. Don't own that. Don't say, I should have done that when it is not even in your control. Right? That is another point of self-responsibility.
Yeah. And one more aspect is let's say raising a child, both the parents are equally responsible. So only the mother taking over responsibility for something that has gone wrong in any relationship.
No, that again depends on the dynamics of the relationship. Suppose the relationship is clear. But you take the responsibility for the tuition for the child, I'll take responsibility for something else. Work has been divided between the partners in such a way that you won't feel that.
But in many families, the division doesn't
happen. Division does not.
Actually, it's not division, it's more of negotiation.
Yeah. Of course.
We are not divided actually.
Yes,
sir. If that is the issue, then maybe the issue is with self-awareness.
Of what you're in control.
Exactly. So that is why self-responsibility is taking the meeting.
No, see, you're aware that it is not in your control sometimes, but you're still apologizing because suddenly you feel I'm responsible for this.
Exactly.
No, you know I am not responsible for this, but still you're apologizing for something. You're not going to feel good about it when you come back out of that meeting, isn't it? That I had to, I'm always like, somebody asks you to bowl your trolley. That's what you're doing. When somebody asks you to, just bowl your head, if you start trolling, then your self-esteem is going to take a beat.
And when you talk of personality perfection also, I feel the personality perfection is usually when it is within one comfort zone.
Yeah.
That person, they are perfect only to that level. They are not flexible later.
Yeah,
only that till that they are perfect and they want to perfect only that.
Actually, when you aim for personality perfection, you're going to have a huge issue of self-esteem. Because perfectly nobody can be personality perfect. When you are saying I have to be a perfect mother, perfect daughter, perfect daughter-in-law, perfect sister-in-law, when you are attaching the perfect to all the roles that you want to play, you are attaching perfect to all the personality that you should be there. I have to be a perfect mom. There is nothing like a perfect mom. The moment you say I am going to be a perfect mom, you are aimed for trouble. Right? So don't aim for personality perfection, aim for work perfection. Work perfection is always welcome. It is needed also. Otherwise, we will never get the good things done.
We never strive to become better.
Yeah, if work perfection is not there, we can't send the aircraft to the Mars and land it in such a perfect manner that at least we get things done. Isn't it? Work perfection is absolutely essential. Otherwise, you don't do good work.
But in workplace also, this perfection word, generally it has negative
connotation.
Because the moment the person feels that he is perfect, he starts micromanaging.
Yeah, absolutely. He has to look at everything. Perfectionism is also a need for control.
Yes.
I need to control everything. I need to control everything. You're looking for a perfect town. My house should be perfect. The party should be perfect. Aim for it. Prepare for it. But expect that things will not go as well as you have planned. Don't try to manage all the unmanageables also.
And not enjoy the process at all.
Yes. Not enjoy the process at all. What are you trying to do? You're not even enjoying the process. No, going there or doing something. You're just aimed at a destination. No, if you are focused only on the destination, the entire process now goes for a loss.
I trust this.
Yes, and much of happiness comes from looking at the process rather than at the destination. So we look at the third aspect of self-esteem, that will be self-assertiveness.
Srikant, what do you think of
Amir Khan? If he is aiming for perfection in his job, I have no issue with that. See, somebody, now I want to be a perfect actor. You know, I want to give a perfect shot. You are aiming for work perfection. When you are aiming for work perfection, then you come up with good quality stuff. If you don't aim for that, you don't have any good quality stuff at all, isn't it? Whether it's a product, whether it's a service, you have to aim for work perfection. So when we look at self-assertiveness, assertiveness is a method of communicating. Right? It's important that we communicate assertively when it is needed. You know, there are three different ways of communicating that we normally do. One is a passive way of doing it, one is an assertive way of doing it, another is an aggressive way of doing it. So which form of communication are you employing? If you are not assertive, assertiveness means standing up for your rights. Standing up for your values, standing up for your morals, ethics, whatever you believe in.
Ability to say no when you really want to say
no. When you really want to say no, right? Assertiveness is like, have you had a class on congruence?
Yes.
Yeah. What does congruence mean?
Genuineness.
Aligning your thoughts, feelings and behaviors. When you align your thoughts, feelings and behavior in one, if the three are aligned, you are being congruent. Assertiveness is a tool for the behavior part. You are thinking something, you are feeling something, am I doing what I am thinking? Right? If you are not doing that, if the assertiveness takes a beating, if you are not being assertive, you are going to lose your self-esteem. As an example, suppose you are just standing in a group and somebody is saying that, no, this, you are discussing about a person who is not in the group. Suppose four of you are standing in a group and you are discussing about a friend who is not in the group. You don't like the discussion because that person is close to you. Will you just stand there mutely and take it? Or will you say, no, I don't like this discussion to be there? You are strongly feeling in your head, no, this thing should not be done. No, this person is not like that, it should not be done. Will you take a stand to protect your loyalties to your friends, your family, whoever you are? Or will you just let it go? If you let it go, you are going to feel miserable later.
Because you are being disloyal to yourself at the cost of
your loyal
partners.
You are not going to feel good about nothing. At the end of the day, you feel, I should have gone and told them at that point of time. I don't like this discussion, but I didn't do it and I'm going to feel miserable, bad about myself. When you do that, your self-esteem is going to take it because you didn't stand for what it is. Self-assertiveness is as important in close relationships as it is important in a distant relationship. Sometimes it's easy for us not to be assertive with an auto driver. You know, it's easy for us to be assertive with the shopkeeper. But can I be assertive with my mother? Can I be assertive with my dad? Can I be assertive with my in-laws? Can I be assertive with my spouse, my children, wherever it is needed? No, assertiveness is not a punishment, or it's not saying something and hurting others. It is getting what you want without stepping on somebody's toes. Can I get what I want without stepping on somebody's toes, without raising my voice? Assertiveness says that you speak in the same tone that you use for normal language. When you are not assertive, what happens? When you are not assertive, the whole thing starts building up. You know, I needed to tell, I didn't tell. You're just piling up the whole thing, and then one day it's going to be aggressive. When you're going to be aggressive, you're going to say the things that you don't mean. When you're going to upset the whole relationship. When you are being assertive, you are saying this relationship is important to me. But what is happening is not nice. And I need to tell this person that what you did is not correct. Right? So that is the assertiveness part of the way. You are able to tell the person what you need to tell without offending them, but still getting your way and still maintaining the relationship. Is that clear about assertiveness?
Yes. See, one of my observations, maybe I am wrong. Whenever you try to be assertive, in a one-to-one situation, as you said, maintaining the tone and being not emotional about it, tends to work. And sometimes it does misfire also. And especially in the group dynamics, if you are assertive and you are against the rest of the group, somehow the connections get broken up.
You see, how you are going to put the words across matters a lot. And we often are not assertive because we have some fears. You know, we have a fear of losing the belonging. We want to belong to a group. You know, we want to feel loved.
Losing a relationship when you are assertive.
Losing a relationship. We are afraid of all these things. We are afraid of losing a relationship. But I just want to tell you that when you are being assertive, don't think whenever you are assertive, it's the end of the relationship. Every fight doesn't have to end it's not the end of the relationship. And here, assertiveness is not about fighting. It's not about arguing with somebody of how, what you did, what I did. It's not too memory. It's not that. Right? I'll give you
How to be assertive? I just give you 4 steps on how to be assertive. Let us see now whether we can do that exercise.
Is being diplomatic also assertiveness?
Yeah. It's being diplomatic. You are saying I want this.
Yeah.
But I'm not stepping back and you are wanting this. You are honoring your needs. You have a need, you have a want. Right? Assertiveness is also giving respect to yourself, saying my needs, my wants are as important as your needs and wants. I am not going to suppress my needs and wants just to please you. Okay, this is my needs, this is my wants. I need these things. And how do I put it across, that is important. My needs are not honored, my wants are not honored. I want these things, but I am not able to say that I want these things. I think if I ask for this, the relationship is going to go for a toss. If I ask her, my friend, for this thing, which she is not giving it to me, which I need from this relationship, then I think my relationship is going to break. Then you have to think, but do you need that kind of relationship? Then you are going to walk all over constantly walk all over. What is the point in having the relationship? Are you going to be allowing yourself to be, it's like being a sucker for punishment. Why are you being a sucker for punishment? Isn't it? Do you want somebody to, keep beating you all the time? Important relations, I'm not saying you have to be assertive all the time. There's no need not to be assertive. Sometimes you go to a restaurant, you're sitting with your family, and you say, what do you want to eat? If I don't feel that I can eat anything, I can say, yeah, whatever you want to order. That's not passive behavior. When you say you order whatever, because you don't want bother about it, you can eat whatever you want. But suppose not today your friend like, no, I want to eat fish. And you go up to this friend and somebody says, what do you want? You want to say that, but you're not saying that. No, you are looking at everybody now, what everybody eating, what if they think, if I eat fish, something is wrong, whatever it is wrong. So I want to say this, but I am not saying that, then you are not being assertive. Right? You are thinking, if I say this, what will happen? What is the worst thing that can happen if you say, I want to eat fish today? One thing that you need to remember is, the moment you are assertive, your respect is going to go up hugely. People like the people who are assertive. People like the people who are clear in their intentions. There's no ambiguity about you now. Whether you like this, whether you don't like this, I don't have to keep thinking about it. You are making it clear to me, look, I like this, I don't like this. I don't have to again look at her and say, does she like this or not? She's already made it clear to me, she doesn't like it. When you are being self-assertive, you get a huge respect of other people. Relationship is not going to get destroyed now by that. Yes.
Is frankness and
assertiveness
the same?
Frankness and assertiveness is the same in the sense of how you put it. Let me give you another 4 steps of yes.
But sometimes
I'll come to this point of, I'll just give you the 4 steps of assertiveness. Look at whether you can put it through whatever the assertiveness that you want to do. And if you put it in that way, are you offending people? Yes.
I feel when I assertive, whatever the hurt, whatever is temporary.
Absolutely.
It is always, the truth is known to the personal. Adding on to Suresh, that connectivity was not there at all.
Yeah.
It's not that because you were assertive it is broken or something. That was not there at all. That relationship was just clinging on. That's it.
Yeah. See, assertiveness.
I just wanted, what she said, one is passive.
Yeah.
Of course, in a marriage, one is passive, one is egoistic. Like she's saying, it would have just been held on.
Right.
But when the passive becomes assertive, it is a blow to the ego and the relationship reaches the status quo. Many times. Okay. That means the relationship didn't exist the way it should have from the beginning.
No, one more thing. Sometimes what happens is we mistake thinking that if I'm assertive, the relationship is going to break or something is going to spoil. Sometimes when you're assertive, the other person says, why didn't you tell me this before?
Yeah,
how many times does it happen? If you didn't like this, why did you think? Why have you been putting up with all this before? It is your fear. It is your fear of belonging, your fear of losing the relationship that's holding you back. If you talk to that person in the way that needs to be talked, there's no need to worry about it. And always think, when you are being assertive, there's a chance that something can backfire. But it's a temporary thing. It's a short-term pain. Sometimes if you are not been used to being assertive, becoming assertive is a short-term pain. Can I do this? There's a fear now, can I voice my opinion here? But look for the long-term gain in that. If there's a short-term pain, there's a long-term gain because you need to do it once often. And then the person, if they understand it, fine. Otherwise, you have to keep repeating doing that. Assertiveness is also training. You are training yourself, you are training the other person in the relationship. You are saying, I don't like this. I don't want to be like this.
Something like constructive criticism also, is
somewhere. Yes, a constructive criticism, but let me come to the 4 points, then you understand. If you want to be assertive with somebody has done something to you, and you want to be assertive, let me give you an example. Suppose you have decided with your friend that after this conflict club is over, we'll go for a movie. Last week you have decided that let's go for a movie after the conflict club, and for you, going for a movie is not easy. You have to do hundreds of arrangements at home, you have to have the food ready, you have to get the children ready, you have to have somebody to come and say, it's almost like, you know, you have got to get a passport visa ready for going to the US. You have to do so many things, nice, you want to go for a movie with a friend. You have done that, you come to the class, counseling club is over, you say, let's go for a movie. She says, no, I can't come with you today because I've agreed to go with her, not for some other job. I'll do that. You said, okay. She says, let me talk, fine. Again, next week, she decides, let's do it next week. I mean, again, the thing. Then you say, okay, next week we'll do it. Again, you have made a workout of arrangements to go for a movie. You again come, stand here, at the end of the counseling club, you're enthusiastic because you want to see the movie with her, because you value the relationship with her. And you have enjoyed that time with her. Again, then you say, let's go for a movie, and this time I'm going to Palmaja, she has decided to take me for a month, I have to go with her.
But the warning signal has come first time.
Warning signal has come for the first time. So, two times now she has let you down completely. How are you going to be assertive? Let me give you the four steps now, how to be assertive, and see now if you can put it in that framework. The first thing to be assertive is now is make a statement of fact. Always make a statement of fact. Tell the person what has happened. No, don't add any spice or any tadka to the whole thing. No? Without adding any masala, just tell them what has happened. Right? That's what you do. First step is you always tell them what has happened, what is the event that has happened. Then, second step, how did it make you feel? Second step, now you tell them how it made you feel. When this happened, how did it make you feel? Okay? Third step, ask for a small change in behavior. Small and specific change in behavior. And fourth step, how that will make you feel. I'll just repeat that. First is make a statement of fact. Always state what has happened. Second, how it made you feel. When this event happened, how it made you feel. Third, ask for a specific and small change in behavior from the other person. And fourth, if that person makes that behavior, how will you feel about it? Okay, just let me explain. Suppose you say, make a statement of fact without adding any spice or anything like that. Now, the friend has let you down two times. How will you, what is the statement of fact? How will you state what has happened?
You made this plan twice and both the times you've gone back.
Correct. You have made the plan twice not to meet each other, and both the times you have told me at the last minute that you are not coming. Can she say no?
She has to.
Right? When you, can she deny that she has done this?
But she can go round about and give answers why she didn't do it.
That's fine.
Many times it happens.
That's fine. That's an excuse that she comes up with because she is defensive. Right? Yes. We are looking at, if I am making a statement of fact, can she deny that this has happened? Can she get into an argument, no, this is not what we did. Right? When you make a statement of fact, you just tell him this is what happened. Like she said, twice we made this arrangement to go for a movie and the last minute you let me down. She has to nod ahead. Right? Now you say, how it made you feel?
I felt let down.
You felt let down?
Let down by what you did.
I felt let down by what you did. Or I felt you're taking me for granted. You're not respecting my time.
The important thing is to say, I feel.
Exactly. When it comes to the feeling part, do not blame the other person. Assertiveness is not about a blame game. Right? When you get into a blame game, it becomes tutu-mai-mai, it gets into an argument, it becomes a whole big thing. See, normally when we are aggressive people, when something like this happens, you say, last time also you did this, but I was already doing this. So you always take me for granted. I just don't want to ever come with you for a movie. Don't even talk to me.
You said that, you go to that extent of cutting off the relationship entirely before something like that has happened. You often cut off relationships. Not necessary, isn't it? So can you make a statement of fact? Can you make how it made you feel?
No. Own the ownership of the feeling. Don't say that you didn't come, you have not come twice now and you are making me feel miserable about the whole thing. The moment says you are making me feel miserable, you are putting the blame on the other person. She is going to respond saying, what do you mean I am feeling miserable? If you don't want to come, go ahead, don't come. Next week also we will not come. You don't want to come, fine.
You just break up the whole thing now in one swift shot. If you own the ownership of the feeling, if you say I feel betrayed or I felt let down, can she say no? You're not supposed to feel like that. This is your feeling, right? You take the ownership of the feeling. That is the crucial part now of being assertive. But I am feeling like this because of what you did. You did this, I am feeling like this. Now ask for a small statement, a small and specific change. Don't make it global. Don't make, can you always keep your time? Can you always keep your promise?
know, if you say, can you always keep your promise? You are asking for something, you know, huge. You know, can you always, do you always break promises? No. Can you manage to keep your promise next time? It's too huge. What's the small and specific change that you want?
If there is any changes here, would you let me know earlier?
Inform me. Next time when we do it, can you inform me earlier that, because see, I make a lot of arrangements to come here. Can you inform me earlier that if you are making a last minute change? And she said, no, I will not inform you earlier, I will always inform you the last minute. But see, all the entire thing of assertiveness is to have the other person nod a yes to you. You know, not get into an argument with you, not say, no, who are you? You know, it comes down to that, no, who are you, what are you, all that it will come down. Why bother that? You're asking for a small and specific change. Next time, you know, when you don't want to go, can you just tell me in advance? I'm asking for a very small and specific change to this relationship, this particular thing, this particular event. I'm not globalizing the whole thing and saying, no, can you keep your promises next time? Or can you manage your time better next time? Can you learn something about time management? You know, all these things are just come out of your mouth very fast. Ask for a small specific thing. This is what I want you to do. And how does it make you feel if she does that?
Happy.
I feel comforted. I feel like you care for me if you make this change.
Can any of these persons, when you do it, can the other person get into an argument?
Actually, it starts with an argument.
Because they already have past history.
Before we complete the plan, the other person will get angry.
We'll get angry. Because the plan is saying, how are we communicating it? Communicating becomes a crucial thing here, isn't it? If I can communicate to the person in such a way that I am not attacking his personality, I am not saying that you don't know how to manage them. This is the way to do it. You can never give promises, can you? I am attacking him. And at the moment I am attacking him, he is going to feel defensive and hit back at me. Right? We are just ignoring the thing of that has happened. It's a small thing that has happened between you and me. Can I ask for a specific thing? Can I say that this is how it will make me feel? I will feel cared for if you just tell me before. I will feel like you care for me. Can somebody say, I don't care for you? Then the relationship is not good. Suppose now the person says, no, I can't do all this. Then what are you the thing for? What are you fixing, going out with them for? Are you wanting to be a doormat? Right? So it's always important that you be assertive. The moment you are not assertive, suppose this happens. Second time she has disappointed you, and you say, you want to go to Padmaja's house? Okay, go, enjoy, have fun with her. You are telling her all that with her faults, now you send her back and you are fuming inside. You say, how could she have done this to me? No, second time she did it, I made so much arrangement. Now what do I do? Go back home and cry for myself. Then the dog gets it, the servant man gets it, everybody else. Lower level hierarchy, whom you can check off. Gets it.
You carry over systems,
you pass it on to others. Whereas this is the person you have to take it on, isn't it? Suppose you put your foot down and say these things. You know, next time it doesn't happen, you know now that you are in the legitimate person, I'm walking out of the whole thing. I'm not making an arrangement with them, because you don't want to be a doormat. Right? You don't want to be saying that I'm a carpet, you can walk all over me whenever you want. So, unless you are being assertive, your self-esteem will take it. Suppose you go back without being assertive, how many times has it happened? You know, people have taken you for granted, you don't tell them back, then you go and fume inside.
And you don't want to hurt them, you know, many a times we hurt ourselves,
that's why
we don't hurt them.
No, that's what I'm saying, you are hurting them, why are you hurting them? Where is the hurt? Where is the attacking them? The moment you attack them, now the whole thing comes. If you are not attacking them, where is the question of hurting them? Assertiveness is communicating your needs, your wants, your rights have been violated. You have a right to complain. You have a right to complain. How do you complain? Right? How do you complain now makes it as whether it's an assertive behavior, whether it's an aggressive behavior. If you don't complain, you are being passive, you are saying roll over. No, you can walk all over me and take it. The moment you are not assertive and you can be taken, the other person realizes that I can take this person for granted, you can be 100% sure that this event is going to happen again. Right? I know that she'll take it. So, I can take her for granted now. Next time also I will fix, next time also I will say no, I could not come. Whenever I am comfortable, I will come. So whenever I have free from other things, I'll come and do this. But if you are not being assertive, you don't get your self-esteem. It's a very important part. So if you can sense from your counseling that this person is not being assertive, and that is the component that is affecting the self-esteem, can you help to work with them on that? Right? Each of the three components we look at it now. When we are talking to the counselor, we are seeing, is a self-acceptance issue, is it a self-acceptance issue? Is it a self-responsibility issue? Is it a self-assertiveness issue when it's hurting the self-esteem? The last point now is achievements now.
fights, lads, and because of assertiveness, all these things play. So how can you deal with that? When you know everything started and later you start making facts and statements.
Not later. One important thing about the point she raised about being assertiveness is be assertive at that point. Don't allow the thing to go over. Okay, let her go. I'll tackle it now 2 days later. No, 3 days later, now the person has forgotten what it is all about. And 3 days later, you come back and say, you know what happened that day you left me for the movie, which movie? That day you said, no, you come for the movie. Oh, that! Where assertiveness? Your assertiveness gets punctured, na? Because you're preparing, na? Okay, let her go this time. Let her go home this time. I'll tackle it next time when she comes.
No, the problem is you're already so furious. You're more aggressive than being assertive.
That's what you have to be aware of. You have to be aware that you have to always know all emotions. If you become aware of it, you're conscious of it, you will know that this has happened. I will not allow my voice to be raised. No, first thing that comes is anger. How could she do this? Okay, she has done this. I am angry about this. I am going to convey that in my tone of my voice. I am going to convey that in my expression. I didn't like what you did. I am not going to convey it after 3 days. It doesn't work. Right? You're building up yourself for that. You know, she has gone. You're building up for tomorrow. I'm going to tell
her. Many times it happens. After the third day, we try to convey outside.
It doesn't work. Because the issue is gone. The emotions have gone. Your emotions are still there. That person
actually, I think women are very much like that. Men forget, but women
do. So, if you want to be assertive, the important point is be assertive when the event has happened. Not that 2 days later, I mean it has not, then the whole thing has kind of fizzled up, you know, it is another intensity. And when you convey it at that point, the person will remember it, that this person I can't take it for granted. 3 days later it comes, now I'll deal with it. 3 days later she's going to be assertive, now
I'll
deal with it. The topic only gets changed. What, 3 days later, you're still talking about that now, huh? You know, the whole thing, you have prepared yourself, now. Four statements, I have to make 4 statements.
The previous ones also comes up.
Akbar's time, what happened in people's time and all that, and the whole comment is lost.
Because they say that if you are in anger, you shouldn't speak. You should control and then you have to speak.
No.
It takes 2-3 days.
No, if you are angry, na, I would say, na, be aware of your anger and see, na, can I be assertive here? No, not be angry, not be aggressive at that point of time. Yeah.
Okay, I have one more point. Like, the person is already bouncing on you. And because of her bouncingness and her feeling so bad, and you start becoming assertive and you're telling, okay, fine, I want to tell from before, the issue goes on more and more.
No, that's what, don't allow the thing to escalate. The moment she comes and tells her, hey, look, I can't come for a movie to you now. See, it's training. All assertiveness is training. It doesn't come now just because I have given you 4 points. Today you can't go and start saying that from today. You're going to practice it. Assertiveness is a behavioral training for yourself. And you are training the other person. I am not only training myself to be assertive. Suppose she is the person who has disappointed me. I am training her that I am not going to take this.
Not take me for granted.
Don't take me for granted. I am not going to take this. I am going to tell you back now if I don't like this. It's a training that comes from repeatedly doing it. See, anything that you are doing today, right, is you have done it for the last 20 years of your life. Definitely you can do it today, huh? Without a blink, isn't it? So whether it's a driving, whether it's a thing, it's a skill. Assertiveness is also a communication skill. Huh? How do you develop that? Right? So when we come to the last point of achievement, this is a huge role in people's self-esteem.
Now, do I feel successful?
Or do I not feel successful? If I am feeling a failure in my life, I am not going to feel successful. Success and failure, there is no absolute what is success and what is failure. It depends on each person, it is different. No, this person, what he or she wanted to do, can she do that? Hasn't she done that? If she has not done that, her self-esteem is going to take a beating. All these things may be there. I am self-accepting for myself, I will take all the responsibility for myself. I am assertive when it comes, but I feel a failure now because I am not, that is what I wanted to do. So if the thing is there now of lack of achievements, whatever the thing, it can be the smallest thing now, like I wanted to have an education. Sometimes counselors come to us and say, I wanted to have an education, but I got married in such a way that my education got disrupted. For her, that is a huge thing. For the human being, what's the big deal? So many people are educated, what are they doing with that education? Isn't it? You might feel like that. But for her, I need that degree in my name. I need that degree not to say that I have done BA, BCom, BSc. Whatever I have done, for me that is an achievement. For me that is important. For you as a counselor, it will not be important. So am I here not to see that is this an issue for her? Does she talk repeatedly about her failures? Does she talk repeatedly about her dreams not coming true? If that is the thing, can I help her na, in that achievement process? Can I identify na, what are the issues she will feel successful about it? Could be a small thing like parenting. I wanted to do this now, but I am not able to do this. Can we help her na, in that? That will help. When you help somebody in their achievements to achieve their goals, you are going to be super successful. Right? Because something that is very dear to them. Nobody is taking interest in them. Because obviously, perhaps she is not taking responsibility for it in some way, another issue could have. Whatever be the issue, the achievements are a category by themselves, the achievements and accomplishments. It is different for different people, and we have to be sensitive to that. If it is important for her, that if she wanted to learn music, she has not been able to learn music. What she is going to do with the learning of music, that's different. But for her, I wanted to have learned that music, or I wanted to have learned driving. I don't learn driving, it makes me feel very low. So if we can identify the smallest accomplishments, if we can even give them the smallest help in getting their dreams or achievements, it boosts their self-esteem like nothing else. Yes.
Making them come from the need, the truth, the ego.
I don't know.
I don't know. Because they'll be thinking about this, I can do this, but they're not able to move forward and do it actually.
Exactly.
It's in them that they can do it.
Exactly. That's the whole
decision
thing.
That small point they should come out of that.
Sometimes we motivate them, but what does she want? If she wants to be a good driver, can I motivate her not to achieve that? The moment she can drive even the car through the main road, so she'll feel very good about it. No, her self-esteem is at a different level. It boosts the confidence, and sometimes the self-esteem spills over to other areas. If you're feeling good about something, you feel like other things are easily achievable. Right? So can you identify the achievements or the accomplishments that your counselor wants and help her in that? That will boost the self-esteem of the person. Yes.
See, I feel that I have not achieved.
Yeah.
Is it a low self-esteem?
Yeah, it depends on what you wanted, what you didn't get. See, I wanted to beat this.
I have not achieved anything. Is it a low
self-esteem?
No. How do you
feel about it? Exactly.
How do you feel about it? See, sometimes what happens is some of us I wanted to achieve so many things. I had a long list of things I wanted to achieve.
I
wanted something else. And I'm okay with it. Maybe I wanted to be an actor or I wanted to be a cricketer or whatever. But today I'm doing something else, I'm okay with it. Today I accept the reality for what it is. That could have been that dream, maybe it was foolish. I could not have done that. But if you are feeling like, even today I can do that. When the counselor comes to you and talks about issues which even today can be done, like education. It's a huge thing for people, getting a job. I wanted to be on my own. I wanted to have my own finances. If you are not controlling that part of it, you feel low self-esteem. Can we help her to do that? That's the thing about accomplishments. Yes, maybe yes. If there is nothing else, I just wanted to have another round of discussion of 10 minutes each about these two topics. How is self-esteem?
Is self-esteem linked with the goal? Let's say I have a goal, I want to achieve this. I have taken responsibility for it, I am doing it. But at the end of it, for whatever reasons, I am not able to achieve that goal. Then, does that lead to low self-esteem?
It leads to low self-esteem depending on what you talk when you are a failure. Okay, if you don't want the discussion of yourself, I can take another 10-15 minutes.
I expected 90 and I get
18.
For that child, it's a failure. A person who's really failed, which is why I and this children who don't get what they want, they think it's failure, but actually it's not.
No, there's nothing like absolute failures. My failure is my failure.
Failure is when you give up time again.
Yeah, so when does that happen? When do you feel your self-esteem gets a hit? When you get a failure?
Yes, please. Should we use the word failure?
No, that's up to you. We can use the word failure. You have failed at something.
No, I didn't get the desired outcome.
Right. So, suppose even we use the word failure. Because that is something that we all face. I wanted to go for a driving test. I just failed.
No, I couldn't do it. I will try it.
If you can use that, fine. So, I am coming to the point now of what you are telling yourself. That's what you are telling yourself.
Yeah.
Right? The pessimistic way of telling yourself, there are three pieces of pessimism. Right? The first is permanent. There is a pessimistic way of looking at things when you fail. Right? The first way I look at it is, do I make my failure permanent? You know, do I say, I will never be able to do this? Do I say, I am always like this? I go for a driving test, I fail the driving test. Do I tell myself, I will always fail my driving test? Right? When you are using a word like never, always, forever, what you are doing is, you are saying there is no scope for change. Right? Because even when your child comes and tells you that I have failed in this exam, do you tell him, you are always failing in this exam? Am I making it permanent? The moment I make it permanent, it sinks into him that I am always failure. Right? It is not this event. It is not this time that you have failed. You are always failing. You are putting it across the entire time. You know, the next whatever decade, whatever lifetime you have, you are a failure. Right? So am I using the word permanent? Am I using permanent words when I describe failure? If I am going to use permanent words when I describe failure, like she said, it could affect your self-esteem. Right? I'm saying I can never do this ever again in my life. Which is not really true. Right? Driving test, exam, whatever it is there, it's a one-off event. To describe it, suppose somebody has come and failed and you want to tell your child that he has failed. Okay, you failed this time. You failed this time. I failed this month. No, narrow it down to localize it. Do not make it global, do not make it permanent over time. When you make some failure permanent over time, it will take your self-esteem. Is it clear? The second P of pessimism would be pervasive. What does pervasive mean? Covers everything. You know, I fail in a driving test. I'm not going to come back to you and say I failed in my driving test. I never do anything good. Right? I never do anything good. Your child comes back and says, I failed in maths. You never pass any exam, is it? Can't you do anything properly?
You're always like this.
You're always like this. Right? Always.